Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Tom Inglesby, Director of the UPMC Center for Health Security, and I'd like you to welcome you to this morning's event. We're very glad you all could join us for this. In a moment, I'm going to introduce our honored guest, Dr. Ziad Memish, but just a few words about the format of the morning. We're going to begin this morning with a presentation by Dr. Memish. He has some slides and some remarks to give. Following that, he and I are going to have the chance to discuss some of what he presented and some of the questions to help elucidate what we have been learning about the MERS outbreak over the last year. And as we get about midway through that discussion, I'm going to invite questions from the audience. And so if people have questions at that point, we'll ask them to come up to the standing mics and make your questions. We have until noon today together. And before we begin, I want to thank very specially Scott McNabb of Emory University and Jen Nuzzo from our center for their hard work in putting this together. It was a great collaboration to make this event possible. So now I will introduce our honored guest and speaker. Dr. Ziad Memish is the Deputy Minister of Health for Public Health in Saudi Arabia. He's also director of the WHO Collaborating Center for Mass Gathering Medicine. He's a consultant in infectious disease at King Fahd Medical City, on the faculty at the College of Medicine at Al Faisal University, King Saud University, Emory University, and the Liverpool School of Medicine. He obtained his MD from the University of Ottawa, became board certified in internal medicine and infectious diseases, and received the American Certification of Infection Control. He's received numerous international fellowships of distinction, including the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Canada, the American College of Physicians, the Infectious Disease Society of America, and the Society of Healthcare Epidemiology of America, also known as SHEA, and he's a fellow of the Royal College of Edinburgh. He's a member of many of the most important international committees in this field, including the Executive Board of the WHO, the International Infection Control Network of the WHO, the WHO Pandemic Influenza Preparedness Framework, the Executive Council of the Gulf Cooperation Council States for the Ministers of Health, and the WHO Regional Network on Infection Control. Nationally, Dr. Memish chairs the Hodge Executive Prevention Medicine Committee and more than a dozen other committees, including the National AIDS Committee, the National Committee for Communicable Diseases, the National Immunization Technical Advisory Committee, and the National Committee for TB. He has presented more than 250 abstracts internationally, published more than 300 peer-reviewed publications and chapters and books, and has founded two academic journals, edits for reviews for 17 others, and is an editorial board member of yet others. For this body of work, he received the highest national award in Saudi Arabia for achievements in infectious disease and infection control. Over the last year, Dr. Memish has emerged as among the most important health leaders in the world in the response to the MERS outbreak. We are so appreciative that you've joined us today and agreed to share your views of the MERS outbreak and your insights about the implications for health and security.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure and honor to be here, and great thanks to Tom and team at UPMC for this kind invitation. It's been great 2 days to be here in Washington, D.C. What I'll try to do over the next 25 or 30 minutes, try to run through what we at the Ministry of Health, with a huge public health team there, have done in investigating this new virus that emerged last year. So as of today, and 15 months after the first reported case, a total of 96 confirmed cases of infection with MERS corona has been documented, with about 47 deaths. Out of these cases, 76 have been reported in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and about 39 deaths. Over the last 6 months or so, we're picking up more and more asymptomatic and mild cases, especially among the contacts. And this is being expanded now because we're doing more extensive testing among contacts of new cases. Of course, outside of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, there have been cases reported in countries in the region, including Jordan, where two confirmed cases were documented among a cluster that occurred in April 2012, and 8 were done in retrospect by doing some sero-surveys. In the region as well, there were cases documented in the UAE and in Qatar. Some of these patients were referred to other countries in Europe, including the UK, Germany, France, and there was also a case in Tunisia where the person has spent some time in the Middle East region and traveled back to Tunisia. He died from the disease, but he was never confirmed by testing, but his two contacts were actually confirmed, his son and his daughter. So this is basically what's going on over the last year and a half. This was the title of an editorial that actually came out in print in the last issue of the Lancet Infectious Disease this week, from Kristen Drosten, "Is MERS another SARS?" And just to bring back the memories of SARS, which occurred in 2002 and 2003, and over 5 to 7 months, there were a total of 8,098 probable cases with 774 deaths that cost the economy $30 billion. And in his editorial on the report of clinical scenario of 47 cases, he mentioned that the striking difference to SARS is the high rate of underlying comorbidities in patients with MERS. A virus not yet fully adapted to human infection might be more likely to cause illness in people weakened by pre-existing disease. And that seemed to be the pattern, where we're seeing people with a lot of comorbidities who come down with the severe disease, but the people who are healthy and well seem to do well and have a very mild and sometimes asymptomatic disease. So take you back to the first case. The first case was the first case from Bisha, a 60-year-old Saudi businessman who was previously healthy, was a non-smoker. He had an extended family. On June 10th, he was admitted to a local hospital in Bisha with symptoms suggestive of community-acquired pneumonia. Then he moved to Jeddah with his son, walked into a private hospital, and 2 days later he became extremely ill, required intubation in the ICU, and developed acute renal failure requiring hemodialysis, and expired 10 days after being admitted to that facility. This was in June 2012. There was, of course, no news of this until 3 months later, when there was a short report in ProMed by Professor Ali Zeki, who worked at that hospital at that time, which stated that there's a new coronavirus that was discovered and caused the mortality in that patient. And that's when the Ministry of Health and Public Health Department, when I saw that ProMed report on my BlackBerry, of course, the team was dispatched immediately to the hospital to review the details of that case and to do the investigation. Also at the same time, there was communication with WHO regional office and the headquarters, and also discussion with colleagues at CDC, Columbia University, and Echo Health Alliance to visit us and work with us on trying to do the initial investigation of that case. So there was an extensive investigation done on the family members. There was at least 29 family members involved related to this case, and also about 100 employees who worked at the different facilities in Bisha and also in the private hospital in Jeddah. All these investigations have not revealed any positive cases. So this puts things in perspective with the dates. So the case was admitted to the hospital between the 13th and 24th of June, and then the patient died on the 24th. We are aware in retrospect that in mid-July, Erasmus Medical Center received the sample and obtained the cultures of this new strain. On the 20th of September, that's when the ProMed report was released, and then notification was done to us, I guess, through that ProMed report. And this was, unfortunately or fortunately, it was just a week or 10 days before the Hajj season starts for 2012, which puts an unbelievable pressure on the public health system in Saudi, trying to strategize and put the measures in place to prevent any spread of the cases to pilgrims coming from 180 countries. So at that time, the Ministry of Health convened the National Infectious Disease Committee, and basically we reviewed the information available to us at that time, And then a rapid communication was made to your surveillance, putting out some requirements, where we basically revised the case definition put by WHO and stated anybody who comes into the hospital in the Hajj premises at that time, including Mecca, Medina, and Jeddah, with pneumonia, would be required to have a sample done for novel corona and also taking serum to test for infection. These samples were tested in our regional lab, and again, we're appreciative to the CDC team, which visited us within a few days of the report and set up the lab at the regional lab in Jeddah. These tests were again sent to Public Health England to confirm, and luckily none of the 300 samples that were collected during that season were actually positive in our lab or in Public Health England for testing with MERS corona. As well, there was some collaboration with colleagues from Europe. Philip Guttert from Marseille also tested his pilgrims before they came to Saudi with PCR, and then he tested them while they were there and then tested them on return, and none of them acquired MERS-CoV during 2012. So this was another reassurance that there was no transmission of the disease happening during the Hajj season. But you can imagine the pressure that Public Health Directorate was put under during that season because of the late notification of the case. Now, every year, the Ministry of Health, through the National Infectious Disease Committee, meets on a regular basis. Our meetings actually start after the Hajj finishes. Every year, we review what went well and what things can be improved, and we try to put recommendations for the next season. So last year's Hajj finished in late October. We put the recommendations early in the year of 2013 because that's when the Umrah season starts. So between January and end of July, before the month of Ramadan started, we had close to 8 million people coming to do the Umrah from many countries, and no cases were documented except for one case that was a UK that person that came to Saudi in February and spent 6 days and then traveled back to the UK. And he infected some of his family members. And also the month of Ramadan has actually passed, and we've had almost 15 million people perform the Hajj from within the country and from outside. Close to 5.5 million individuals came from outside of the country, and not a single case of MERS-CoV was reported in the kingdom or in the countries that have received the pilgrims on their way back. So we tend to put these recommendations in an index journal where physicians and healthcare workers have access to it, so they know what recommendations that we're putting forward. In addition, it's sent through the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Saudi to all the embassies abroad and also all the travel agencies so that they know what the requirements are. And again, before the Hajj season starts, so this is the last issue of the WER, WHO publishes the requirements for the Hajj with specific indication if there's anything new, then there will be new requirements. These recommendations have two categories. So there's requirements for visa issuing, and these include the meningococcal vaccine, that is a requirement to get the visa for the Hajj, the polio vaccine for countries who have active polio, and also yellow fever for people coming from countries having active yellow fever disease. And then the rest of the recommendations are actually recommendations. So for this year's Hajj, the Ministry of Health has put some recommendation, basically recommending that the elderly and the very young, people with chronic diseases, and also people who have immune deficiency, are recommended not to come for the Hajj this year, and then to postpone it to another year. Because it was based on what we have seen with the comorbidities among the patients who acquired MERS-CoV and passed away. It seems like most of these categories of individuals seem to be at increased risk of having the disease. After the Hajj season, and you know, we've continued to have sporadic cases with some clusters happening among family members. We've documented two clusters that occurred among family members. We have the first cluster that occurred in October 2012, where we actually picked up the second patient. This is our first indication that there was a cluster going on. So this is the son, the elderly son of this patient, who was admitted to a private hospital with severe pneumonia and basically went into ARDS requiring intubation, ventilation, and passed away within 2 days. When this report came to us to the ministry, we investigated. We found that this person was actually taking care of his father in one of the Ministry of Health hospitals. This was a private hospital. So we went back and looked at the history of the what we think is the index case. And this was an elderly man who has been actually in the hospital for some time. He came in with symptoms suggestive of congestive heart failure. He had some UTI symptoms. He was in the inpatient facility for some time. His clinical situation deteriorated, had a low-grade fever. He was seen by an ID consultant, suspected a pneumonia going on under the congestive heart failure. The patient had a BAL, which was negative, and the patient basically developed ARDS and renal failure and passed away. We were fortunate to find one drop of his BAL in retrospect in the pathology lab. This sample was tested and was positive for MERS-CoV. So we think this is the index case that caused the transmission. So this is his older son. He had two children. One of them, case number three, was the person who was alternating with him, taking care of the first patient, 12-hour shifts. He also became ill, and he had positive MERS-CoV results. And then the second son also had symptoms, but his results were negative. So we have a cluster of three confirmed and one probable case in one family. And that gave us the indication that it seems like the virus does spread among the same family, but not extensively. Because when we went back and looked at the family had a household of, he had 18 kids, 9 boys and 9 girls. Some of them were married and they had children, and they were all living in the same villa. So there was an extensive family, and all the details are actually mentioned in the report. But we've done extensive testing on the family and follow-up on a daily basis for 14 days. None of them developed the symptoms. Then, of course, the late October, the report came about the cluster in Jordan, and that was the two confirmed cases that were tested in Namur 3. Namur was involved in an investigation of a clustering of cases in Zarqa in Jordan in April 2012 that caused two mortalities, and there were a lot of healthcare workers involved. When they tested the samples of the dead individuals, they were positive for MERS-CoV, and then they went back recently and tested. They did some serious surveys on the other people involved, and they had some 8 more positive cases. Then we had another cluster in February 2013 in the same family. Again, we got involved with this case, which again was admitted to a military hospital in Riyadh. Again, with classical symptoms of cough and pneumonia, requiring ICU admission, and the patient expired. When we were notified of that case, again, investigation led us that this person had a brother who was admitted a few weeks before into another hospital with multiple myeloma. He was actually in the ER for some time, and then afterwards required to go to the ward, and then developed pneumonia and required ICU admission, and he died. Unfortunately, we could not find any samples on this patient so that we can test for MERS-CoV, but we think this person probably is the index case for this cluster. Again, shortly after, the brother came in with similar symptoms, and luckily he recovered and discharged home. So this seems to be the pattern. When we do the extensive investigations, most of these families come from extended families, but it seems only certain people get infection and not the others. And that's why we think that there's probably some genetic underlying disease that makes certain people more predisposed to acquire the disease. So this is from the second cluster. You can see the three patients with their symptoms on presentation. None of them had GI symptoms, although in the bigger cluster in Hassa, we've noted that a significant number of them had GI symptoms. They all had pneumonias. A significant proportion of the patients to date have been having lymphopenia and thrombocytopenia, and two of these individuals required ventilation and had some renal dysfunction during their course of illness. Then, of course, the whole world is aware of the bigger cluster that happened in the eastern province of the country, in Al Hasa, where we had a significant number of patients acquire the disease. This cluster, again, we were notified on the 22nd or 23rd of April of an increased mortality in one of the private health facilities in Al-Hasa that was a JCI accredited. And Al-Hasa, for people who don't know the area, it's about one quarter of the total area of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. It has a population of 1.3. It has hospitals that belong to the government, the private, National Guard, and also some clinics for Aramco. This is the facility where the cluster started. It's a 150-bed general hospital in Al-Hafouf. It's JCI accredited. It has a 16-bed hemodialysis unit caring for 43 patients. It has a critical care area, negative pressure room in both hemodialysis and CCU. And of course, there were other hospitals that got involved, because once we involved in the investigation and we confirmed the first case on the 24th of April through lab testing, we closed that hospital for new admissions. So some of the patients had to be transferred to other facilities. Basically, our investigation indicated that there were no increase in mortality, but it was a shift in the cause of mortality. So this was a facility that tended to care for the elderly, so it's like a geriatric hospital. And the infection control team who was working there, they were extremely good, and they were able to find that the mortality cause was shifting to a pneumonia versus the usual cause of mortality. And that's where they alerted the health directorate in the region, and then the Ministry of Health was alerted. Basically, an extensive investigation was done where we went back and looked at the medical record of patients who were in that hospital for the 6 months prior to the beginning of the illness. And we think that the first cases probably started the beginning of April. Now, at that time, we called up our colleagues from the U.S., Trish Pearl from Hopkins, and Derek from Hopkins, and we also called colleagues from Canada, Alison McGeer, who was actually working very hard during the SARS outbreak many years back. And they came and were working with us closely, looking at the cases and reviewing the charts and trying to make some sense of the significant number of cases that were either confirmed or probable with MERS. At that time, we had 23 cases were identified. All confirmed cases and 11 probable cases were part of a single cluster involving four healthcare facilities at that time. And basically, we drew a diagram based on our best knowledge by looking at each patient. And this information would not be possible to collect if the hospital was not so good in documenting everything for every patient. They had an outstanding documentation. In the dialysis unit, they had documentation on where the patient was, in which chair, every time they had dialysis three times a week. So we were able to take that information and try to map when the patients come in contact with each other and try to make some sense of the transmission chain that happened and caused the outbreak. Of course, immediately infection control measures were implemented, monitoring hand hygiene, and they had a compliance of almost 75% at that time. Implemented droplet and contact precautions, which is what WHO was recommending. Also testing patients with fever for MERS-CoV, and then putting masks on all patients undergoing hemodialysis. We also found some practices that we immediately stopped. The hospital used to provide transportation service for the hemodialysis patients by sending them an ambulance with two beds in the back. So the hemodialysis patients were sharing the same ambulance going back and forth to the facility, so we basically stopped that practice. And then we did not allow any patient with a suspected disease to go into the unit, enhancing environmental cleaning and excluding visitors and non-essential staff. And these are the different hospitals that basically picked up cases since the cluster was identified. And luckily, this outbreak was cleared, and we're not seeing more cases from that region. When we looked at the EpiLink, patients with probable EpiLink to confirmed or suspected cases were 23 out of the 30 cases documented in that region, and patients with animal exposures, including camels, birds, bats, and cats, were 10 out of the 30. And this brings up the difficulties with trying to find the animal reservoir or the the animal source, because when we go and ask the questions repeatedly to the families and the cases, we don't get too much information. And then we tend to go back and forth to them, trying to see if they can remember if they had any contacts with cats or with birds or with camels. It did not seem like there's a lot of links to these animals. So we've learned lessons from this outbreak. MERS-CoV can cause healthcare-associated infection. That's why we have basically ensured that all the hospitals, whether in the country, follow good infection control practices. We know that early symptoms are mild and nonspecific, and they can be missed if the physicians and the healthcare workers are not alert. 1/3 of the patients had GI symptoms in this big cluster. There is also apparent heterogeneity in the transmission of the disease. Person-to-person transmission does occur, but the mechanism is still not clear. And all the hospitals should follow the droplet and contact precautions when they follow patients. There's no solid data to confirm if transmission only occurs when patients are symptomatic. We don't know if they can transmit before the symptoms start. Lab testing with PCR is the standard now, but we know that if you take deeper samples, you get better results. So that's why if you suspect the case to be MERS-CoV and you get a negative result, we always go back and take a repeat sample. And if it's negative, then we really suspect that this person have MERS-CoV. We request that a deeper sample is taken through BAL. And of course, we're working with partners and colleagues, the CDC, NIH, and other locations trying to standardize and validate the serological testing. Now, a lot of discussion has been going on about the potential source of the community infection, and these are the different culprits that are being thought about: bats, livestock, stray dogs and cats, pet birds, rodents, and camels. And I'm sure you've seen the recent report published in the Lancet Infectious Disease a few weeks ago, documented that there was some positive serology on 50 out of 50 camels tested from Oman, which has not documented a single case of MERS-CoV in humans since the start of the clustering. And also they've tested camels from outside of the region, from I think Spain and Chile and other places, and they found 15% are positive by antibody. And the question is this significant? That's still to be determined, because we don't know if the serology is actually accurate in humans, never mind in animals, and never mind in camels, which have a very complicated immune system. From what I've been told by our colleagues in the veterinary service, camels apparently have the most complicated immune system. They have nucleated RBCs, and they have, apparently antibodies to many different coronaviruses. Of course, there's also some suspicion that bats are the source, and maybe dates could be the source, and that has not been confirmed to date. We have, as I said, from the beginning, when the first case was notified to us, we have worked with our partners in the U.S., EcoHealth Alliance, which has an extensive experience in dealing with bats and animal disease, and also with Columbia University, Professor Ian Lipkins and his team. And they have visited us on multiple times. The last visit was just a few weeks ago, where samples were collected from different locations in the country from the animal side. And we think that the bats are the source of the virus, but we don't know what is the intermediate host. There have been more than 1,000 samples of 7 different bat species from Saudi that have been collected, and there are many, many viruses in there, coronaviruses, and we think that there is also MERS corona is coming from the bats. But the question is, we know that from looking at all the patients to date, we have not been able to document the relationship between the patients and the bats. Serology is something that is ongoing with a lot of activity happening in different parts of the world. There's teams working on serology techniques in Europe and also in the US. And hopefully we're trying to work with these teams in a collaborative manner to try to identify what is the best serological kit to use to document either new infection or old infection among individuals in contact with the disease. So what we have learned so far, we've learned that the pattern of transmission can actually be one of 4 ways of transmission: either sporadic community cases with presumed non-human exposure. We've seen family clusters, at least we've seen 2 in our country and maybe one in the UK. We've seen also healthcare acquired clusters that happened in Jordan, in Zarqa, and also in Al-Hasa. And also we've seen the travel-related and workplace transmission, which was the case that was reported from Italy. The person spent 40 days in Jordan, went back and infected the hotel receptionist, and also infected a young family member. What we've learned so far about the pattern of clinical presentation, we know that MERS-CoV can cause very severe disease with high mortality in older patients, in immunocompromised patients, patients who have underlying conditions, whether it's diabetes, hypertension, or heart disease, and also in primary index cases. But we also know for sure that the virus causes mild or asymptomatic disease in previously healthy and young secondary cases. And we have reported on 7 out of the 11 healthcare workers that have had positive disease during the last year in Saudi, and these were mostly nurses, again, young nurses who are healthy except for one nurse who was diabetic, and all of them had actually very mild disease. And you know, I bet you if you don't look, you will not know that these people have actually had symptoms, because we've actually, in the first few cases, we put them in the hospital and they were monitored by the nursing staff every 2 hours to see if they've actually developed fever. And some of them had one spike of 38.5 or 38.9, and then it goes away. And this is associated with muscle aches, pains, you know, and feeling unwell. But then within 24 hours, these symptoms disappear. So if you're not careful, you probably will not be able to detect these cases. And again, we did have some severe cases among healthcare workers. We had one physician who passed away, and this physician was diabetic and obese. And we've had some one nurse who had pneumonia documented. When we looked at the exposures and what were the risk exposures, we can see that these individuals were actually involved in very invasive procedures with the index cases. So most of them were either involved in intubation of the patient or suctioning the patient during the early admission to the hospital. And of course, according to the recommendation put forward by WHO, the procedure for infection control is contact and droplet. But if you're doing invasive procedures involving aerosolization, then you're supposed to be using airborne precaution, i.e. using the N95 and the goggles to prevent any transmission. And of course, it's no failure from the nursing side, but it's failure that when the patient comes in, they don't know that the patient has MERS-CoV. And of course, when he gets sick and he gets intubated, they do the best that they can to serve the patient, but then sometimes they'd be at risk. And this is basically a slide from Dr. Nikishinde from WHO indicating, which makes a lot of sense, that the disease has a varied pattern of clinical presentation depending on the host and the underlying illnesses. We've tried to summarize some of the clinical presentation of our cases so far. And you can see that the majority of patients have fever, chills and rigors, cough, and a shortness of breath. And then there are some other symptoms that are milder that appears as well. Most of the patients, as we said early on, do have comorbidities, and I think, you know, if you read the editorial from Professor Drosten, he mentioned that it's hard to judge on small numbers of cases because in Saudi the incidence of diabetes is around 28%, and also the incidence of obesity is also high, so you cannot tell if these are significant risk factors when you're looking at 40 patients or 50 patients when you're looking at a disease which is NCDs are being endemic in many countries in the world. But we also know that the more comorbidities you have, there'll be a higher chance of having higher mortality. I think that is very clear from the analysis of the data so far. Of course, there are a lot of gaps. I know that this slide will not show, but just to show you that there is a whole list of things that we do not know and we need to work on with partners across the globe to try to address some of these issues. I know that we will not be able to answer all the questions very quickly, but I think we have to prioritize what are the questions that we need to look at and address very promptly. And of course, the issue of therapeutics is very important. We are looking at all the data that's been published to date at what have worked and what have not worked in SARS, and trying to sort of try to attempt to use some of these interventions. And of course, out of transparency, the Ministry of Health, we have established a section of the website of the ministry where the cases are actually added on a daily basis. So at 5 o'clock each day, there's a team from public health and from the public relations and from the information system department. They meet and they discuss any new cases, and if there are new cases, they are documented on the website. And at the same time, these cases are reported to WHO according to IHR requirements. Of course, we think that in closing there are some challenges. The reservoir of the virus remains to be determined. Infection control seems to be effective if they are applied stringently, but sometimes it's difficult to apply it across the board without knowing that the patient is positive when they come in. There are still some diagnostic challenges with the sample type, the false negative, the lack of serology, which is validated. Also, we need to work on some therapeutic approaches so that we can give these people some therapeutic modalities. And then, of course, case control studies are being planned and being done. The take-home message is MERS-CoV is a novel virus which has limited transmission among families and social contacts. The virus selectively causes severe disease in the elderly and the immunocompromised. We still don't know where the reservoir of the virus is, and the challenge exists with limited therapeutic modalities. Thank you very much for your attention.
Well, thank you for that really useful and thorough discussion of what you've been doing and what you've been learning over the course of the outbreak. In our discussion now, I wonder if you could say a bit more about the beginning of your talk, about how this all came to be, because obviously all of us are always thinking about our strategies for initial detection of virus in country and novel viruses. It sounds like it was a difficult situation for you in that you weren't aware that this virus was being investigated for some time in your country. Do you want to say a little bit more about that?
Yeah, as I mentioned in the presentation, I think the case was admitted in June and died at the end of June. And it seems from what we have been able to collect as far as information that there was suspicion that there was something going on, and there was communication with an outside organization to do some further testing, but the Ministry of Health was not aware of anything going on with the new virus until the report came out on ProMed. And luckily I follow ProMed religiously, so you know, seeing anything unusual because of the Hajj and Umrah, we have to take, you know, first to investigate and ensure that the information is accurate, and then after that, you know, we take the appropriate interventions. If it wasn't for the ProMed, we would not know until the report came out in the New England Journal of Medicine, I think that sometime at the end of September or beginning of October. So
10 days before the Hajj, you read on ProMed that 3 months earlier, an unknown infection had been suspected and an investigation had been started, but you'd had no information about that investigation.
Exactly.
Is there a rule in Saudi Arabia about people having to report unknown diseases to the Ministry of Health?
Yes, of course. The policy in the Ministry of Health is there is a reportable disease reporting system, and the diseases are classified into categories. So there are certain diseases that are supposed to be notified by phone through a system and fax, and there are diseases that are reported on a monthly basis. Of course, any unknown disease that would cause a significant morbidity or mortality needs to be reported immediately, and that system is applied across the board in all hospitals, whether they are Ministry of Health, military, university, or private hospitals.
And if you had found out about that unknown, or that the possibility of an unknown virus, you would have taken your own steps to get that presumably sequenced and identified rapidly. And
for sure, because we do have collaborations with many international organizations, including CDC. You know, when we first knew about the case, mm-hmm. the first thing we did is we called the WHO and CDC. So I think, you know, working with partners is very important when there's something new, where there's a risk of public health, you know, concern nationally or internationally. So I think if we knew earlier, I think more review and more discussion and more interventions would have been made.
Okay. So since that time, since discovery, what's the strategy for surveillance and testing that you all have put in place? And has it evolved over time, or how does it work now?
So basically, when we knew about this case and the Hajj was coming, we've set that circular that Mecca, Medina, and Jeddah would be testing anybody who has pneumonia requiring ICU admission for MERS-CoV. After the Hajj has passed in 2012, And since we've had more cases discovered through the clusters, we've made that recommendation across the whole country. So all the hospitals kingdom-wide were supposed to follow the same procedure. Now, as you know, when you request a new requirement from, 200 or 400 hospitals kingdom-wide to say that anybody who has a pneumonia, please send a sample for MERS-CoV or for whatever pathogen, the compliance will not be very high. So we assume that the compliance was not high. But as the disease progressed and as we've had more cases, I can assure you that every single physician and healthcare worker, whether they're working in the Ministry of Health, in the private sector, in the military, or the universities, or even in the primary healthcare, they're aware of the disease and they're suspecting it, and they tend to send us the message immediately if there are cases suspected.
So at this point, all patients who are admitted to ICU with a respiratory illness would be, as a matter of course, tested.
Yes.
And anyone, if you don't require ICU admission, it's still possible to get a test. If a physician suspects MERS for any reason,
yes,
the order gets done, and those results will get transmitted to the Ministry of Health.
All the testing was centralized in one region lab in the Western region, which is a lab that was set up early on for the disease. And the lab is now very experienced in doing the testing. In the last 2 weeks, we've expanded that testing to involve two other regional labs, the central region, which is Riyadh, and also the eastern province. And we're following the same procedure and the same policy, and all the testing is done for free. So all these tests are done centrally and reported to the Ministry of Health and then reported back to the hospital.
So there's an incentive. In other epidemics in other parts of the world in the past, there have been disincentives to report in the sense of, either people weren't interested in bad news. It seems like in Saudi Arabia it's very much expected and encouraged and automatic for people to test and forward results.
And we have invested significantly in ensuring that that information is made public. We have developed news release, and we have on our website information on when to suspect the disease and where to go if you suspect that the disease is there, so that the appropriate samples are taken.
And how many of the cases that have occurred in Saudi Arabia are now, do you believe, are linked to each other? Or is that still information that's being developed as opposed to spontaneous new cases?
I think, most of the cases that we report, like I've presented, most of the cases are sporadic cases. And then, for every single case that we get reported, immediately a team gets dispatched. That team will basically look at the patient in the hospital and then look at every contact in the hospital and then collect the appropriate information. And also a team is dispatched to the patient's house. And then again, detailed information is collected based on what WHO requires on the significant contacts, anybody who has other illnesses, if there have been any unusual exposures to somebody who's ill or somebody who's died, either within the family or outside the family. And it depends on the case, the investigation can expand. And we have not seen anything that is out of the ordinary. I think the largest that we've seen is the Al-Hasa, where everything was linked to that single facility. But we have not seen sort of a lot of clustering happening outside of one single family.
In terms of testing, the testing process itself, it said in your Lancet article that just came out that you get more than 70 reports of suspected MERS cases daily, which is
a
pretty substantial number. How do you handle those kinds of numbers?
I think the testing is autopilot. The team that's working in the lab is dedicated. They work 24/7, even on the weekends. So the samples are received every day, are tested in the same day, and no sample is saved till the next day. So the system now has been going on for almost a year, and I think we're hoping that the new other labs that are being operationalized will take the load off on the lab agenda.
And what, for patients who are suspected of having MERS, do you just keep close tabs on them? Are they hospitalized while their test is being run, or do you keep close tabs on them so that you can find them if they were positive?
Most patients who are tested are patients who are actually hospitalized. So these people tend to be still in the hospital. And we have close links with the physicians looking after them. And if the suspicion is high that this is MERS-CoV, then more testing is done. And we have picked up a few cases where the initial testing was negative. And because suspicion was very high, we went back and took more samples, or we took deeper samples, and the results were positive. And the ones that we did not have samples on, we still suspect that this is probably either an index case or a contact of a case, we report it as a probable case.
And there's been some discussion in the blogs and in the press about sequences and the number of sequences available in the world. What kind of sequencing capabilities do you have either in country or do you rely on outside of country? How's that working?
Again, in the spirit of collaboration, we are working with the Sanger Institute in the UK, where all our samples that are positive are sent to the Sanger Institute on a weekly basis, and then you know they try to work on the sequencing. I think the problem that we are facing, plus the other scientists who have had cases, that not every single case you can actually find the full genome to be able to do the full analysis. But we've been able to report 5 genomes from the Al-Hasa cluster, and there are now 21 more genomes that are being finalized to be reported on the gene bank, and they should be coming out in the next few days. Once the details are completed, and they'll be compared with the whatever is on the gene bank right now, which is 9 virus.
Right. Okay. And for the ones that are not, the cases that don't have gene bank sequences, it's because it's not been possible to recover.
Exactly. Entirely. Because you know when they do the testing, some of the tests are, as you've probably seen in the last report, depends on how much viremic that patient is. Sometimes we get good samples with very high viral load, and that usually the scientists at Sanger can do the full sequencing, and sometimes they can do partial sequencing, which is also helpful. But then sometimes when the CT value is very high, when it comes above 30, 35, then they will not be able to do any significant sequencing.
And in terms of patients, your discussion of your detailed discussion of what happened at Al-Hasa was really useful, as was the paper. How has your healthcare community been able to deal with this? I think many of us who haven't lived through what you've lived through would presume that there'd be a lot of anxiety or concern in healthcare workers showing up for work when there's a case of MERS in their ward. Has that been challenging in Saudi Arabia? How have you been able to manage that?
We have not seen that. I think the healthcare community has been very committed. As you've seen, you know, most of the physicians and the nurses and the paramedical staff have been very committed to provide the best services to the patients. And you know, we stress on the proper infection control procedures that should be followed, and we follow them very carefully. Once there is an index case, you know, we either put them initially we used to put them in the hospital, but that used to be a bit of a nuisance for them. So now we ask them to monitor their vitals at home, and then we have either somebody visit them every day, or they call them once a day for 14 days to ensure that there's no, you know, progression, no fevers, no muscle aches, no pains, and if they have any progression of symptoms, they're immediately admitted to the hospital.
And one of your papers said that 80% of your cases in Saudi Arabia have required mechanical ventilation, which I think for people who work in the ICUs, infection control is particularly challenging when you're in that setting. Has that been something that's been manageable? It seems like not only is it an infection control issue, but it's an ICU infection control issue, a level up.
Yeah. Well, I think we're learning every day. I think early on we thought that everybody who gets MERS-CoV is going to require ICU and is going to get sick and is going to have a high mortality. When we started, I think the mortality was almost 67 or 65%. Now that we're accumulating more cases, the mortality has dropped to 40%. And I think it will continue to drop if more screening is being done. And I think other countries are encouraged to do the same. I think the Ministry of Health in Saudi has invested in being very proactive and looking for the cases and providing the information to the global community. And we hope that the other countries in the globe will be doing the same.
I think you've said something like that before in one of your other talks on this. So do you think that Saudi Arabia is finding more cases because you're looking harder? I mean, is it your intuition that other countries would have a similar burden?
I think
if they looked as hard as
I feel strongly that this is the case. I think EPI-101, you know, if you don't look for something, you will not find it. I think you have to look for the disease. And if you're not testing and you're not doing anything, you will not pick it up. You know, I think also we have a huge expatriate community. You know, we have 7 million individuals who come to us from other countries. So if this disease is only happening, you know, in Saudi, how come these people are not being picked up when they go back to their countries? Or why there's no cases in the countries where they come from? So I think you know, I think the WHO is making recommendations that testing be done on patients who fit the case definition. The question of how aggressive you apply that recommendation depends on each healthcare system in each country.
So your intuition isn't that it's not only that there would be more cases in the region, but that there'd be more cases in the world if we begin to test more intensively.
That's my suspicion. You know, I could be wrong.
Okay. But that's good to know. I mean, you're in the middle of this. It's good to know your suspicions and intuitions, even if they're still early. Back to infection control. So there's a bit of discussion in the world about how serious infection control measures, what level of infection control measures should be used for cases of MERS. Some debate about whether it should be airborne isolation or whether respiratory droplet precautions. So your sense so far is that respiratory droplet and contact should be sufficient? Did I take that from you, just to make sure?
We're confident. I think, you know, once the case is confirmed, we've had many cases who stay in the hospital for a significant amount of time. We have not seen any transmissions once the patient was identified as a MERS-CoV and the application of the droplet and contact was applied stringently. You know, we have not required to put the patient in negative pressure, and we've had many cases in Hassa where they were in a regular room. And, you know, we have not had any transmission.
Even in ICU patients, which are more difficult, you've managed them with droplet precautions.
I think if the patient is ventilated, is being suctioned, and there's some aerosolization, then I think
then
it's a different story. Yeah.
Okay. So tell us more about what you think about the paper on camel transmission. And we got the beginning of your analysis there, but do you think that the camels are a likely source?
I think the paper is well done. I think they've looked at a large number of animals, including camels and sheep and other types of animals. I think the information that's provided by that paper is very useful. We have actually been looking at the camel in our country, and we have sent some samples to the U.S. Unfortunately, there was some delays in getting the samples in, but the samples are in the U.S. right now, and they have been tested, and further testing is being done on it. So it will be interesting to see if we get similar results. I'm a bit more cautious with the serology results, especially with the animals, and we're working now closely with the animal health organization, trying to sort of liaison and do appropriate sampling of different animals and do the appropriate testing for them.
And so in terms of animal testing, you've clearly been working with Dr. Lipkin's lab and EcoHealth Alliance, and you described your collaborators there. For other animal investigations, do you have a need for or a plan for working with other laboratories internationally in terms of animal testing?
I think based on the discussions with WHO, we have requested that since there is an organization which is international that deals with animal health and animal disease, we wanted them to be involved. So right now, the organization dealing with the animal disease has been in contact with the Ministry of Agriculture. There is a national zoonotic committee in the country that I'm involved in. And basically now we're looking at what animals should be tested and what kind of samples should be collected and how many. And hopefully, FAO and OIE will tell us which labs will be able to do the testing on these samples.
And including it sounds like you have an arrangement with the U.S. to do testing.
Yes. Right now we're working very closely with Columbia University, and they're doing the testing for us.
Okay. Back to the issue of international, since we're kind of on the issue of international sample sharing, I think you've said in the past that sending specimens to that the Dutch university at the beginning hindered your investigation. Do you want to say a little bit more about that so we can learn from the experience?
Well, you know, I think international collaboration is very important. I think there are certain, you know, trust issues that need to be established, and the Ministry of Health in Saudi collaborates with, you know, many organizations for a long time. I think, you know, as I said, when this thing started, we were sending every single sample after it's being tested in our lab, Public Health England. We had no, you know, we had no concerns or reservations because the system was clear. You know, there was transparency. There were But we're, you know, we don't work, you know, with organizations that have a system of, you know, taking the virus, patenting it, and making mm-hmm. it difficult for others to work on it, and then there will be some, you know, issues with finances and, you know, incentives to produce vaccines and produce drugs and produce diagnostics. I think, you know, that makes things more complicated. But when it comes to science, I think we want to work with rigorous organizations that have, you know, ethics and credibility in dealing with, you know, international collaboration.
Did you ever get that virus sample back from the Netherlands?
We were supposed to sign an NTA to get it, so no, we did not.
You didn't get it back yet. Okay. And so your national policy now, if you describe it, is basically to seek international collaboration actively for whatever problems need solving.
Yes.
You've listed a number of international organizations along the way, but it sounds like that would be your overall interest is to collaborate around these issues.
Exactly.
Margaret Chan, I wrote down a quote from hers from May, which was, making deals between scientists because they want to take intellectual property, because they want to be the world's first to publish in scientific journals. These are issues we need to address. No IP will stand in the way of public health actions. What do you think of that?
I think that's a very wise statement.
You agree?
Coming from a wise woman, yes.
Okay. And what do you think about the need for a framework, a pandemic influenza preparedness-like framework for viruses that are not influenza? Would that be a good thing? Would you be worried about that?
No, anything that would be discussed, negotiated, and clarified, you know, among partners, I think that would be very useful. I think the PIP framework is working well. I think there's a system in place. There's a committee that has, you know, different countries involved, different regions of the world involved. And I think if there's a consensus, I think that's the way forward.
Okay. So when a new virus emerges in a country and is discovered, should that country have responsibility for that virus, or is it the kind of thing that you think it should be an international authority and responsibility? Should the WHO have some kind of authority? It seems like a lot of these issues were raised at the beginning of this outbreak. How do you, just going forward, if you could magic wand in hand for the next country that has a virus emerge in its borders?
That's a good question. You know, I don't know what the appropriate answer is. I think it is important to put public health first, and I think anything that will ensure the public health security and safety, that is very important. But I think also, you know, credit should be given to the appropriate people who discovered the virus. And I think nobody would argue if physician A picks up a patient and he's intelligent and he goes and searches further and find that this is something unusual and it might be something new. I think that person should be given the credit as a scientist who have thought of the issue and then taking it further. But I don't think he should bypass the public health infrastructure of the country. I don't think any public health officer in the world will accept, you know, to have something significant being slipped away to another country in silence and then risking the country's security and also other countries' security for personal interest.
So, and in terms of, it kind of leads to questions about information sharing generally. What's the balance been like for you to try and at the same time protect the people of Saudi Arabia from MERS, at the same time trying to keep the global community informed? How is that, has that been complicated to do? Is it in terms of challenging in terms of resources?
You know, I think for me as a person, I'm learning as I go. You know, I think I'm sure anybody who faces a new emerging virus, there's a lot of things that has to be done. You know, you have to make sure that there's a system in place to detect cases early, try to do the appropriate intervention to prevent from spreading. At the same time, you need to make sure that the public is aware of what's going on. And also the international community needs to know what's going on. It's a complex system. There's only 24 hours in the day. And there's, you know, so much that you can do trying to handle all these issues at the same time. But I think, you know, I think there's a lot that we've learned. I'm sure there's a lot that we will learn as we go along and working with our partners across the globe. WHO has been very supportive, whether on a regional level or on a headquarter level. And then our partners in other countries in Europe, universities, academic institutions, public health agencies, they've been all, very supportive to our efforts so far.
So when you are presenting, you showed the website about the daily, the case tallies. When you release information about new cases, if you have clinical information about those cases gathered, is that something that you feel comfortable releasing right away? If the international community doesn't see additional information about cases, should the assumption be that that information hasn't been collected yet and that's in process, or that there's some privacy reason for that or some other reason? Sometimes, I think you've delivered substantial amounts of information in these papers, but then sometimes there may be a report on two cases like earlier this week and we don't know much about them yet. Is that a factor of just having to collect that information or something else?
I think we follow the IHR protocol, and if you look at all the diseases that are reported, from the global community, there's a system of reporting the information to the IHR. This information should not compromise the personal or the privacy of the individuals. So, I think we report that there's a case, its age, it is sex, what symptoms they presented with, their outcome, and if they're well or if they have had significant disease, if they're in the ventilator or ICU, and also what is happening as far as contact investigation. Anything more detailed than that, I think it will probably touch on the privacy of the patients and the families. And then, you'll have reporters coming to the hospital, you have reporters going to the, facility and going into the details of the patient that you do not want to expose. So I think the strategies we have been following is what the IHR requires, which is the basic information that would be of importance to the global international community.
If there are outside diagnostic technology companies, for example, or outside groups that think they may have solutions or tools that could be useful but need additional testing from convalescent sera or something else related to the investigation, is that something that you would be interested in hearing about, receiving?
Yes.
So outside collaborators.
The yeah. They should come through the door, knock
come
on the door,
knock say, on the door,
and say, we want to collaborate. We don't want people to come and say, we want patient samples. I think that's unacceptable. Nobody just gives patient samples away to companies or individuals or academic institutions.
But they like to collaborate.
I think they should come and collaborate with us. And the Ministry of Health has welcomed the collaboration that we're doing with Ian Lipkins and with UCL and with Public Health England and with the CDC. It's a collaborative effort with a clear intention to produce something that will be useful to the international community.
And can you tell us about the Center for Mass Gathering Medicine, and the first of its kind? I know you're the founder of that, and it relates to the challenges that you have every year with mass gathering, but tell us about the work of that center.
So this center is a national center. It's the kingdom's effort. I'm only one person serving in that center. I think the kingdom and its leadership has been investing significant amount of resources and funding to provide the best care to pilgrims coming to the country over the last many years. And the health services that are provided to the pilgrims are unbelievable. I think the challenges are huge. We have 4.5 million people coming from within the country and outside the country to spend 2 weeks doing a very rigorous ritual. The healthcare services provided include curative and preventative medicine services. At the airports, we give 500,000 doses of polio vaccine as pilgrims come in from certain countries. We have, we give prophylaxis for meningococcal disease to 500,000 individuals. They do angioplasty, they do CABG, they do hemodialysis. Everything is done for free. And that comes from, the commitment.
For 5 million?
For the 5 million people. And that
anyone who has a medical problem gets free service.
That's right. And that's the commitment of the government of Saudi Arabia to provide the best service to people coming to perform the Hajj. Initially, the Hajj was a big event with 4.5 million, but now with the Umrah expanding over the last few years, we are seeing an amazing number of people who come throughout the year, starting from January until the end of Ramadan, which is the end of August, but it goes back 10 days every year. All these you know, people receive the same services that are given to pilgrims during the Hajj time.
And you are having a meeting at your Center of Mass Gathering Medicine in September. What's the kind of work that you will do at that meeting, or what are the issues you will review?
So 2 years ago, the Ministry of Health requested from WHO to share the experience that it had over the years with other countries in developing a WHO Collaborative Center for Mass Gathering Medicine. And that was, of course, welcomed by WHO and was supported. And, you know, we decided that we will have an agenda of things to do with our partners across the globe. We basically started by developing an advisory board where we have scientists from different parts of the world who are interested in mass gathering field. Those scientists meet once or twice a year in Saudi, where we discuss what are the priorities for research in the area of mass gathering medicine. This advisory board reports to a board of directors, which are chaired by His Excellency the Minister of Health, and has also members that represent different organizations and institutions across the globe. It has membership of the King Abdulaziz Center for Science and Technology, which is the funding agency for research in the country. Also, KAUS, which is King Abdullah University for Science and Technology, Public Health England, UCL, London School of Hygiene, and we have actually extended an invitation to other partners in the U.S. to be part of that board, where we basically try to choose the priorities for research in the area of mass gathering medicine so that we can learn in the kingdom how to best manage the pilgrims, and also hopefully make that information available to the international community.
And so thinking about the Hajj coming up, obviously you're spending a whole lot of time preparing for that. You've already said that you do screening at the airports. How will screening for MERS be part of your Hajj work?
So as I mentioned, the Public Health Directorate and the Ministry of Health has staff working in all different regions in the country. We also have public health staff working at the ports of entry, whether they're seaport, airports, or land ports. They receive instructions from the Ministry of Health, Public Health Directorate, based on meetings and discussions and risk assessment of what's going on globally on a continuous basis. So that's why we follow ProMed, we follow CDC report, we follow WHO report, and we see what's going on as far as infectious diseases across the globe. And based on the significance of these events, a set of recommendations are put forward to His Excellency the Minister. If the Minister approves it, then it goes to the higher authority to give it the blessing, and then these recommendations are applied. They're applied in the country, in Saudi, by distributing it to all the ports of entry. Public health staff will apply these recommendations as part of their duties and responsibilities. And also these information are shared with WHO and also with the international community.
So if a pilgrim comes by air, by whatever means, and has a pneumonia, they'll be admitted to one of your hospitals and they're automatically tested for MERS.
Exactly.
So they're treated as just as if anybody else was coming in the hospital.
It's like a citizen working, you know, in the country. So anybody who comes in basically receives the full access to healthcare and will be within the system of healthcare that is provided to everybody inside the country.
So I saw a report that said that I think it was from the Minister of Health recently, that said that you're pleased, very pleased, that there have been no cases of MERS in the last month over the holiday. How do you know, or is it possible to know, what happens to patients when they work to people when they return home to their own countries? If they're sick enough to be tested, but test negative, is there a way to track them or keep in touch with those people?
I think this is the beauty of IHR and you know the duty that is being done by WHO in coordinating between the national focal points in each of the countries. As well, that was one of the mandates for the Mass Gathering Medicine Center in Saudi. We wanted to establish stronger links with the countries that sent pilgrims to us. So having a national focal point in each of the countries that sent pilgrims is very useful so that we can maintain communication if we have concerns about a pilgrim going back or a pilgrim coming in. But the system works perfectly. You know, the surveillance is going on inside the country. We are sure that countries also are applying some sort of surveillance. And if there are cases that are picked up in the countries, we're immediately notified through the IHR system of WHO. and then communication will continue.
So if there were a pilgrim coming from the U.S. and then returning home, and they had been tested for MERS while there, then the focal points in both countries would have connected over that?
Usually what happens if there's, give you the example of the case that was reported in the UK. So this is a UK citizen who went to Pakistan, spent a month there, then came to perform the Umrah in Saudi. He spent 6 days. He felt unwell before he left, but he did not seek medical advice. He went on the plane, he arrived into the UK. He was picked up by the UK Health Authority. Immediately, once they picked up that this was a MERS case, there was an immediate communication between Public Health England and myself that this case was actually in Saudi. Then we got the details. Mm-hmm. We went back to where the patient was staying in the hotels in Medina and Mecca. We looked at the contacts, you know, we tested them. We went back to the airline and we tested the airline crew. We tested the passengers who were in front and the back of that, you know, passenger. So there is a sophisticated system of collaboration under the umbrella of IHR with WHO leading that process.
At this point, I would invite anyone who has a question to come to one of the microphones. And I have more questions to ask, but I'd be happy to invite others. Thanks, Jen. Can you say, since you were a part of this process, anything about the public health, the PHIC, or the Public Health Emergency of International Concern designation that WHO deliberated about? I think you were part of that decision. It was determined that this MERS at this point is not a PHIC. Can you do you concur with that? And if yes, what would make MERS become a PHIC?
It's a good question. I think WHO convened the emergency committee. WHO chooses from a roster of experts, individuals to serve on that committee without having the hat of the country. So when you serve on that committee, you sign that you're not representing your country, but you're presenting your scientific knowledge to WHO and reporting to the DG of WHO. And there have been 15 experts who were nominated to be on that committee. I think the discussion that took place was, you know, very scientific and very rigorous. The secretariat of WHO present the data available to them about the disease. Also, the countries that had affected, you know, by having cases, whether cases originating from their country or receiving patient, also gave all the information to the committee. They were invited to participate. So people from my department also participated in giving information about what was going on in the kingdom and the activities going on. And then the committee deliberated the information that was provided, and then they voted on the disease. Is it considered to be a public health emergency of international concern? And I think there was a unanimous decision that this was not. I think the number of cases, the mortality, and others. These are the issues that were discussed.
Okay. Question.
Hi, yeah, Mike Bray from NIH, and thanks, Tom, for organizing this meeting. I was interested, towards the end of your presentation, you were talking about the seven nurses, the hospital-acquired infections, and all of them had normal chest x-rays. In the SARS epidemic, the experience was that chest CT was, of course, more sensitive, as you expect it to be in turning up pulmonary infection. Do you have any plans to, not for screening, but for research purposes, to look at people who've been exposed or other cases with chest CT?
That's a good point. I wasn't aware. But we, you know, most of these individuals were completely asymptomatic. And the stress was quite high for them just to monitor them. And initially we kept them in the hospital. And then to alleviate these stresses, we asked them to stay at home if they're not in contact with significant number of people or healthcare workers. To put them, you know, under more stress by doing CT scan when they have normal chest x-ray, I don't know how much justification is there, but I think it's something that we need to look at and look at the data more carefully, and if it is important, I think we will consider it for sure.
Yeah, it's certainly not anything that can be done casually, but yeah. You know, with a research protocol, I think that could turn up evidence that you would miss by chest x-ray.
Thank you.
A question from the back.
Hi, Maggie Fox with NBC News. Thanks very much. You said that you had done some surveillance and found lots of asymptomatic cases, or are you just referring to the seven nurses? How extensive have you has your testing been, and how many asymptomatic cases have you turned up?
Okay. What I was, you know, we were doing testing on all the contacts from within the healthcare setting and also the families. What we were referring to, the 7 cases out of the 11 or 12, I'm not sure what, that are among the healthcare workers. But of course, we have asymptomatic family contacts that have turned up positive.
Have you done any general population screening, and is that something you would consider doing?
We have not done that, and unless it's proven to be cost-effective and based on science, it probably would only cause more, you know, concerns and stress to the individuals and the community.
Do we have tools yet available that for which we could actually do a more general population screening?
I think once the serology has been developed and validated, then maybe that's something that should be considered. But at this stage, I think doing PCR on people walking in the street would be a bit difficult.
Don, and then we'll go to the back.
I'm Donald McNeil from the New York Times. In the search for the reservoir, there seems to be kind of a disconnect. You've got the vast bulk of the human cases in Saudi Arabia. The disease has been found, or the virus has been found in camels in Oman. If I understand correctly, the closest bat samples have been from Africa, Eastern Europe, and South America. I think, are you sure you have done enough testing? Is something falling apart in the testing regimen? Why are not more samples from Saudi Arabia being, are they all turning up negative, or what's the surveillance?
Okay, so this is what we've been discussing is I think the joint mission report that was done by WHO, an invitation from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, involved 15 experts who visited us for a week and included representative from, FAO and OIE. And I think the question has been put to the Animal Health Organization to give us guidance on what animals to test, what kind of samples to collect, how many samples to collect, and where to test them. And until that information is given to us, we are not, going around doing testing on everything that moves from the animal population. I think the list of things that I put on my slide are the things that we think, based on the evidence available from experts in the field, that could be a possible reservoir or an intermediate.
Why are other countries moving ahead then? Why is testing being done elsewhere but not where the human cases are?
But doing what? Doing testing by serology that is not validated? What is that going to, I think that's why we said when it comes to human disease, we take our leadership and guidance from WHO. When it comes to animal disease, we take our guidance and leadership from the organization that is dealing with animals. We have not received any clear instructions on what samples to collect, what tests to use, and which labs are ready to receive. Communication, there is no lab specified in doing testing for MERS-CoV. So I think, unless there is clear guidance on what to be done, it'd be difficult to go and collect samples. And what kind of samples? Do you take stool samples? Do you take saliva? Do you take blood? Do you check?
Would you take all?
Yeah, it's easier said than done. I think, this is not the way we do business. I think in science, we wait for the experts in the field to tell us what to be done. And then that has to be based on evidence. And that's what we've been doing. But we cannot, if we're instructed by FAO and OIE to go tomorrow and collect, 15,000 samples of everything that moves other than humans, then we will do it. But we have not received that instruction yet.
So is FAO, OIE giving you guidance so far about what to collect, or are they deliberating about that?
They're deliberating. I think the request to visit has been received by the Minister of Agriculture just a few weeks ago. And we've said that we're happy to receive the team. And I think coordination is ongoing right now. Since animal disease does not fall under the Ministry of Health, it falls under the Ministry of Agriculture, very strong coordination is taking place between us and the Ministry of Agriculture.
And when the team comes, will they actually be doing the testing, or they will be coming and giving you a strategy? They're recommending
a strategy. They'll be giving us a strategy.
And that'll be then the testing itself will be carried out by the Ministry of Agriculture?
No, it depends, because if the testing was available in the Ministry of Agriculture, it would have been done by now. but it took us 7 months to get our samples of the camels into the U.S. because of the regulations and of the system. So once we know what samples to take from which animals to go to which lab, then of course we will act on it.
And the earlier work that you did on bats with Eco Alliance and Dr. Lipkin's lab, that was on your own initiative.
Exactly. Yes, because the Eco Health Alliance team felt strongly at that time that bats are most likely source of the coronavirus, and that's why 1,000 samples were collected from across the country and submitted. And you will hear some information this week or next week that we think, as I said, that the bats could be the source of the virus. But other animals, it's a bit more complex. And maybe I'm not giving the right information because I'm not a vet, but this is something that, we're waiting for clear instructions.
Okay. Question from the back.
Mohammed Yassin, Medical Director of Infection Control at UPMC Mercy. That question is actually for both of you. And I do agree that the more we test, the more we find cases. And I don't see so far anything specific for Saudi Arabia that makes this disease unique to Saudi Arabia. I see Saudi Arabia has a place in the heart or the mind of people because of the mass gathering, that's very understood. But in the meantime, I don't see anything specific that cannot happen in any other place. And I wonder if there is any advancement in the technology. We're going into the influenza season very soon. Are we gonna have any film array, including the coronavirus in part of these viral panel, or the Luminex PCR or other? Is there any more information in making that more commercially available for all the facilities all over? Thank you.
I think it's a very good question. I think, point of care testing is very important. I think it will give confidence to do the testing on individuals that could be suspected to have MERS corona. And also it would be more accessible. Right now it's only sophisticated PCR techniques that are being used. It might not be available in other resource constrained countries. So I think I agree. I think availability of easier point of care testing would be useful. I think luckily with MERS-CoV, I know there are experts here more than me. Luckily from the cases that we've seen so far, it doesn't seem to present like viral upper respiratory tract illness. So upper respiratory symptoms are not significant. It's actually lower respiratory symptoms. So that's a bit reassuring that it will not be confused a lot with runny nose and a cold and symptoms like that. But I agree. I think, having a available, cheap point of care testing would be very, very important. And Tom, maybe you have a comment.
I really don't have anything to add. I think it would be very useful clinically if we had that kind of test. But I think for now, it appears that in the immediate future, we're going to be relying on PCR. And I think you described the state of serologic testing quite well, and hopefully we'll have more information that will help us understand on a population level better. But for people who work in ERs, I think it could be challenging when you fit the epidemiologic profile. This is in the US experience. You either are returning from a country which is known to have cases, and so you meet the criteria for testing here, where it's much more likely for you to have influenza or something else in the absence of rapid testing, but I think that's the situation that we're in at the moment. I have a question from Twitter. Henry Neiman, Dr. Neiman, sent a question in asking about your strategy for detecting mild or asymptomatic MERS cases. Is it based on a modified assay? Is it based on some different approach than you use for clinically symptomatic cases, or is it the same approach?
Same approach.
Same approach. Yeah. Question from back.
Monica Shakspana with the UPMC Center for Health Security. I think I would love to hear more descriptive information about the responses of both the residents of the kingdom and the pilgrims to the prospect of an emerging virus, and what type of public communication challenges and strategies have emerged for health authorities?
It's a very good question, but I'm not sure I represent the pilgrims, so I cannot speak on their behalf. But I think the simplest thing to say is that we have not seen a decrease in the number of people interested to perform the pilgrims or the Umrah. And as I said, the numbers are quite impressive, which indicates that, you know, the pilgrims are confident in the healthcare system and the surveillance that takes place in the country. But other than that, it's best to ask the pilgrims who have come to the kingdom and, you know, hear their opinion.
So are people following the advice that you issued about groups that you think should wait a year before coming, or do you have any data on that from the last month, or are people coming in the same numbers as they always have?
It's hard to say. I think it's very difficult. The recommendations that were put forward are left to the countries to apply. We have a very clear instructions that anybody who wants to come and perform the Hajj will be received with open arms and will be treated like a citizen when it comes to healthcare. So I think it's left to the country to decide if they want to put any restrictions on people going for the pilgrimage.
So a purely voluntary recommendation.
Exactly.
And in terms of just thinking about that question that Monica raised, in terms of risk communication, has it been challenging to communicate about this within country over the course of this? I mean, this outbreak, you've been learning a lot as you go. You do have pilgrims that are coming, which probably require a different communication strategy back to their countries. Can you tell us a little bit about how public information is disseminated about this?
I think for the locally and nationally, I think the website has been very helpful. I think having the information available for anybody who wants to just log on the website and go to the Corona section and look at the updates, I think that has made things much, much easier. People don't have to call to ask for the information, or they don't have to inquire. It's there. It's public information. In addition, I think, as I said, the public relations department within the ministry has been working very hard with my staff on developing material that would be pictorial, with images on, the simple respiratory etiquette that we know that this will hopefully prevent the transmission of disease. And also we're working with our partners at WHO to try to develop, some pictorial messages, and also through social media in a way that will be understood without having it in the too many different languages available globally, but having it in a simple way that can be understood by just looking at a picture.
Okay, great. We have a Twitter question from Lori Garrett, who asks about the phylogeny of MERS patients, MERS points closely to bad species. I'm not sure I'm reading it. Can genetics guide your search? Is that question, am I reading that question correctly?
Yes.
Okay.
And the police is asking about the phylogeny of the virus, linking it to bat species.
So the phylogeny of the virus linking it to bat species, can that be helpful in your search, your animal search, your bat search?
I think so, and I think that's what we're working with Columbia University. I think, a part of the testing that was done by collecting the bats from different regions in the country, and also in areas close to patients where we've had index cases, I think that will give us some information. I think Professor Ian Lipkins and his team are working on this, and it will be made public very close, very soon.
I have another question from Twitter from Anton Randall. Will Saudi Arabia be providing convalescent sera to scientists outside the country who ask for it? I think you began to cover that earlier. I guess under what conditions would that be a possibility for scientists who are studying this disease?
I think it is important to clarify. I think right now we know of at least six scientific groups globally that are working on, diagnostic techniques through serology. Yes, we do collect serum from patients, but these are precious samples. I think there need to be a coordinated way of testing these samples by the different techniques under one umbrella. And I think through the Center for Mass Gathering Medicine, we are hopeful that, we will be working with the individuals and the organizations that are working on these techniques so that we can do it in a proper way and then come up with the best results. I think this is a strategy that we're looking for.
Okay.
Eric Toner with the UPMC Center for Health Security. You mentioned that a number of the patients from Hassa had GI symptoms. And I believe the first French patient had only GI symptoms on presentation. And this obviously presents a problem for clinicians. Would you recommend that someone with a link to the region who has GI symptoms be tested, because there'll be a lot of such patients, or only people who also have an abnormal chest X-ray?
You know, I think the information that we have at this time is not enough to make that recommendation. I think so far we have 96 cases globally, and looking at the, you know, I think one third of them have GI symptoms. The total number is very small, and I think to make any, you know, to make any recommendation based on that information, it would be very, you know, immature. I think we have to know more. I think the more data and the more cases we develop, and I think it will make it clearer if that is a significant part of the syndrome. But I think with the French case, I think the clue was that the person was immunocompromised, that he had the initial GI symptoms, but he rapidly developed a pneumonia. When the CT scan was done early on, they picked up the pneumonia when the patient was not having respiratory symptoms. So I think it's the constellation of symptoms and syndrome and the host that will be the clue to sort of look for MERS-CoV.
So another question from an email, someone watching webcast. Did your plan on publishing case data in journals like the New England Journal, I guess, or Lancet, does it influence your decision when to report case data? I think that relates to things that have happened in the U.S. experience in the past and other places when difficult decisions are made about will case data be released before publication. Does that?
I don't think so. I think once the information is, the Al-Hassa data was, I don't think anybody can do that work in such a short time. I think the collaboration that we've had with, I think, three or four universities from abroad, from Canada, from the US, the huge team that was working on the information, the pressure was tremendous on trying to produce information as fast as possible so that the international community, you know, sees and hears what was going on in details. And I think, you know, people were working night and day, and the speed of producing that document with the details that was produced, I think speaks on the intention of the Ministry of Health to make that information available as soon as possible. If it wasn't for the New England Journal, it would be any other journal that would make that information available to the scientific community. But I think it is a good timing to give credit to the New England Journal, because they have been extremely supportive, and actually they've given us access to give the information to WHO before the information was actually sent to reviewers, which I don't think a lot of journals would do. So that information was actually made available to public health agency of the global community before it was actually made public and released.
So in a word then, the answer would be no, you didn't have information that you withheld for a period of time waiting for publication.
I don't think so, no.
As soon as it was ready to go, it was published.
As soon as the journal took it, the report was made, you know, that made sense, it was made available to WHO, and at the same time it was sent for scientific review and publication.
And when you, this is a second part of that same question, when you provide information to WHO or CDC about cases, is that information typically released publicly, or is there a process of vetting at WHO or CDC, or a period of time where those organizations know it but others don't? How is information disseminated along those lines?
Well, it depends on what information you're referring to. So we will not disseminate detailed information about patients to the, you know, public health agencies across the globe. This has not been done with Ebola, has not been done with any disease that I know of. I'm not that old, so I don't know. There are much more senior people than me in this audience. But I'm not aware of a system that, you know, tells countries to sort of release detailed information on patients to the global community without having that information vetted, you know, reviewed, make sure that it makes sense, that it's been reviewed by scientists who think that this information is credible and worthy of being made available to the scientific community. I think we're following the system and the rules that are applied to other diseases as we go.
Okay. Jen.
Jennifer Nazzo from the Center for Health Security. Thank you for your presentation. I'm really impressed by the amount of information you've been able to obtain from the clinical sector. In the U.S., it's tough for public health because most hospitals are private and sort of out of the direct control of public health authorities. Can you speak a little bit about how information is shared? Is that something that's done easily, or do you have to send people there? Are there direct ways to relay data from the health sector to the health ministry?
I think the healthcare system in Saudi is straightforward. So the ministry is a corporate body that has regional health services in each of the 13 health regions. In each region, there is a health director, and there is an assistant for public health and an assistant for curative health. So the assistant for public health reports to me in public health at the ministry, and also the assistant for curative reports to the deputy for curative in the ministry. And the team that works in that region basically is the team of the Ministry of Health. So it's all one unit in a way, so that basically every case that is discovered in different regions, the same system is applied. The team will go from that region, they will do the investigation, they will report back to me if it's a public health issue, they will report back to the curative deputy if it's something that is urgent and related to the curative section. So the system, has been working extremely well. And I think early on in the disease, we actually had public health assistance from the regions coming to the ministry and developing the command center to sort of follow up the cases, review the charts, and take out the information. You can imagine the country is quite big. For us to be able to access the chart, to access the X-rays, be able to analyze them and compare the data between patient and another, it requires a lot of resources. But I think it was very easy. We had no difficulties.
Scott.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. Scott McNabb with Emory University. First of all, Ziad, I'd like to thank you for being here. For those of you who don't know, Ziad is actually on his vacation this time period, so I appreciate very much taking the time to come here. And I congratulate you on your presentation. It seems like one of the lessons learned out of this for the global community is the need to go beyond the IHR in terms of developing governance for data sharing. Certainly, the idea of trust and transparency are two key components to creating a global health secure environment, so to speak. Would you comment on your thoughts about developing sort of data stewardship agreements that might go beyond the skeleton of the IHR to address not necessarily just emerging issues like this, but more common issues like malaria in Africa or something like that? Appreciate your comments about that.
I think working closely with WHO, I know that the IHR system that was developed was based on outbreaks of new emerging viruses in the past, and again, I'm sure there are more people, more senior people than me in this audience. I think the IHR is a leap forward when it comes to sharing critical information among 192 countries across the globe. For you to be able to get on your BlackBerry at 2 in the morning that there's a case of Crimean Congo in country A, or a case of Ebola in country B, or to me, it's incredible. And I think the credit goes to WHO for taking that leap in making it easy for countries to be able to know that something happening in another country, sometimes a neighboring country. I think it gets more complex once you start to ask for more. And you want more details, you want more patient data, you want more X-rays, the next thing you want the patient chart. It becomes, and I agree with you, it touches on the patient's confidentiality, on the country's sovereignty, on the family, on the privacy. So I think I think a lot of work has been done to develop the IHR as it is, and I agree. I think it needs to be continuously looked at, and I'm sure there'll be areas where it can be tweaked. But I think credit goes to WHO for making that IHR system, which I think it's a wonderful system, and it's working very well.
So I have another question via Twitter from Lori Garrett, who asks, if WHO vets MERS information before Saudi Arabia releases it.
What does that mean? No, the way that we do it, I'm not sure what vet means, but what we do is every time we have a case confirmed, we have to send to WHO within 24 to 48 hours the details of that case. So basically the age, the sex, the presenting symptoms, the status of the patient, if he's well, if he's discharged, if he's in ICU, if he's in clinical ward, how was the case confirmed, and what kind of investigation has been done to date, and if there's any concerns about other cases. And usually it's a standard email that we do immediately once the lab confirms a case. Usually if WHO IHR has a question or unclarity on that specific reporting, they immediately call me back or email me saying that, can you clarify, was that on the 19th or 18th, did the patient had other symptoms and so on and so forth. So there might be some clarification, but they don't have any other concerns usually.
So you'll independently make a decision to report it on your own website.
Yes.
You'll say new case, and then you'll kind of simultaneously
let
WHO.
Yes.
Okay. That's helpful. Was there another question?
Yeah. Eric.
Oh, Eric first. Okay.
I'm just wondering, at this point, do you think that the amount of attention that's been drawn to this new disease is worthy of all this attention? That's my question.
I think, to be fair, I think it's a new virus. Initially, it has a high mortality. There is no known therapeutic modality. There is no vaccine available for it. WHO is the organization globally that deals with public health across the globe. I think it is an important disease, and I think it needs to receive the appropriate attention when it comes to trying to know more details about how the disease spreads and where is the source and how can it be prevented, and to have the resources available to develop the vaccines and therapeutics and diagnostics. Has it been blown out of proportion? I think maybe a bit by the media. And I think the more information becomes available, I think the media has been good in sort of, giving that information to the public. And I think it's something that goes with having a new virus that we don't know much about. Even for us as physicians, when it's frustrating when you're trying to get a message out to the public and you don't know what to say. I can sense that, this makes it urgent, that makes it, important, it makes it relevant to sort of try to work harder with the international community to know more about it so that you can give a message that makes sense, that is appropriate. So it's a difficult question to ask. But sometimes when you look at the global picture and say, 100 cases over 15 months with 45 or 50 mortalities, how does that compare to other diseases that are killing, hundreds of people every day? But it's a tough question.
Chen.
So our friends at Columbia just sent us a press release saying that a 100% genetic match for Middle East Respiratory Syndrome has been discovered in an insect-eating bat in close proximity to the first known case of the disease in Saudi Arabia, and then they linked to your paper, was just published in EID. So now that the paper's been released, is there anything more you care to say about that?
Well, as I said, I think bats were thought of early on because, and I think that addresses the issue of what to go after. I think, from talking to the experts in the field, they were strong suspicion that bats were the most likely source. And that's why the immediate thing that we did when we've heard about the case in September that's when we contacted Ian Lipkins and his team, who are experts in that area, and we've contacted EcoHealth Alliance, and they were on the grounds within a week of the first case. And yes, it took a while because collecting bats is not an easy process. You know, I've learned a lot over the last year, you know, trying to find the right traps, and you have not to kill the bats, and you have to sort of take the appropriate samples, and you have to have the appropriate attire. So, you know, I think it was an effort that was well done by a team of a very, very high caliber, and we've learned a lot from it, and I think it was good that this information is now have been secured.
Scott.
Yeah, Tom, just one more point. Scott McNabb with Emory University. I just wanted to mention that the Lancet Global Health, through the leadership of Dr. Ali Zumla, has begun a global blog around these topics. And so there's a lot of dialogue in the international scientific community about the topic of data stewardship, about viral sovereignty, about national sovereignty, about communication and so forth. So I'd encourage you to go to the blog site, which is the Lancet Global Health, and post your comments, read the comments of others.
Thanks, Scott.
Thank you.
Tom.
So since this embargo, this provision just broke, can you explain what the delay was? Why were Campbell samples coming in from Oman and places like that, and it took so long to get information out of Saudi Arabia? What, you mentioned before when I asked the earlier question that it took 7 months to get Campbell samples in the United States. Can you give, and this is one bat we're talking about?
So the different situations. So there are regulations in countries where if there is a country that has foot and mouth disease, you cannot submit samples to other countries unless they get screened to make sure that the foot and mouth disease has not come into that country. So the Ministry of Agriculture in the U.S. have very strict regulations on receiving samples from ungulate animals from countries where foot and mouth disease have been reported. So to go around that process, we had to get the appropriate approvals, and that has been gleaned by, you know, our collaborators, you know, people at HHS and at Columbia University. We had to go to the right places to get the appropriate approvals and to do the proper procedure of sending the sample in proper containment so it can come into the US, be screened for foot and mouth disease, and if it's negative, it gets sent to the Columbia lab for testing for MERS-CoV. So we have to go by the book, and you know, these are countries' regulations we cannot bypass.
Yeah. Bats don't get foot and mouth disease.
That's right.
This was a bat sample. Why so long a delay on this?
As I said, there were different visits done by Columbia University at different times and looking at different locations where we've had patients. So there was a process of collecting different samples from different locations in the country. And these samples have gone through extensive testing. I'm not a virologist, and I'm not an expert in doing molecular testing for viruses in animals. But the process took a while for the lab to be able to identify the pathogen. And that's why it took that long.
In light of this, think that it's a bad idea to consider there to be a break either in your country or elsewhere between animal diseases and human diseases. This is a zoonosis, and more diseases are turning out to be animal diseases and jump to humans. If the health department says we can't test these animals because the Department of Agriculture says we haven't gotten instructions from the FAO, then the source of the virus is never found. But this call for some new way of handling.
I think that's why the concept of One Health has been, you know, talked about. You know, I think working closely between, you know, animal health and human health and other partners is very critical. And you know, I think this was discussed with WHO and with the FAO and OIE to try to sort of to come with some recommendations to guide us on how to move forward. There are many animals, and you know, we don't know what the, you know, which animals to start testing. And to make the effort focused and worth our while, I think we have to wait for the experts in the field to tell us this is what you need to do and this is how you should do it. So we're working with the right people.
We have two more questions. Maggie in the back, and then John in the front, and then we'll
On the bat study, what do you do with this information that you have? I assume you don't think these bats are directly biting people. So now that you know that there's at least one bat that carries the virus, what do you do next?
That's a good question. I think we've suspected from day one that, and I'm sure most of the scientists working in the field of corona knew that this had something to do with the bats. But I think it was important to document that so that it can be clearly, you know, documented scientifically. And that is being done now. I think we will continue to try to find the relationship between the bats and the human, and there must be something in the middle. Is it food? Is it other animal reservoir? That's something to be determined, and I think that's why I think now it's important for OIE and FAO, you know, to sit with us and tell us what to do next.
Hi, thank you for your presentation today. My name is Michael Cooper. I'm with the Armed Forces Health Surveillance Center, Global Emerging Infection and Surveillance and Response. We fund the Naval Medical Research Unit 3 in Cairo, also the NIC in Jordan, and we're currently funding enhanced surveillance for the Ministry of Health in Egypt during the Hajj and right after the Hajj. And since you mentioned it earlier, we'd certainly be very happy to collaborate with you. I think it would be a great opportunity to share information and to get a better sense of the situation specific to the Hajj, but even following the Hajj as well. So I'll take this opportunity to sort of put you on the spot and ask you for your collaboration.
Thank you. We appreciate that. We already have a signed MOU with the NAMR 3 in Cairo. So this was done when I first joined the ministry 5 years ago. So we welcome the collaboration and the offer to collaborate.
So there's one last question for the you've given us a number of lessons along the way, but for the public health officials and the clinicians and hospitals here who are looking for cases and thinking about how they would manage cases, do you have any final advice for this community and how we should either prepare for or respond to MERS should we ever have a case?
Well, I think to have an open mind, and I think if you suspect that the case fits the case scenario, then I think you should be aggressive in trying to pursue the diagnosis. I endorse what WHO says in trying to improve surveillance across the globe, looking for the disease. I think what that will do to the scientific community is the more cases we have, the more information we'll have, and that will give us more clues on what to focus on and what information we should give the public. So I think that's the way forward.
Well, that I want to really thank you so much for your time here, especially since it's on the beginning of your vacation.
Thank you.
After all the hard work you've been doing over the Umrah and with the Hajj ahead, and we really appreciate you sharing your insights and your observations and your candid discussion today, and wish you the best in the time ahead.
Thank you very much. Thank you.